Welcome everyone to Mount Calvary on this time of worship. It is Father's Day weekend, and this is a weekend where we want to thank godly fathers for all they have done to raise godly children. We are also starting a sermon series on the book of Ephesians for this summer. And today, Pastor Greg will be presenting the message. Mount Calvary is here to love God, love others, and serve the world. We pray. Lord God, be with us in this time of worship. Help us to set aside the cares and worries of this world and focus upon Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, to give him praise and honor and glory, because he deserves it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I'll confess my transgressions to God, and you forgive the guilt of my sin. We take a moment of silent confession. O Almighty God, merciful Father, we confess together, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God to you, and in this debt, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I announce the forgiveness of all your sins. You are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now, as God's forgiven people, let us greet one another with the peace of the Lord. You can text or greet each other any way that you can, but know that we are a loved and forgiven community.
Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky, but my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you'd reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? Beauty of my Lord, be more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? Won't you reign in me again? Won't you reign in me again?
It is Father's Day week, and we have a special little message about fathers that we're going to be playing right now, things that you will never hear a father say. Once that message is over with, think about all the things that good fathers do say, all the times you have heard good fathers say, I love you, or let me tell you about Jesus, or let's just hang out together because you are so special to me. Father's Day is a very special day, and so thank the wonderful fathers that you have known in your life.
I don't care how late you stay out. Stay out as late as you want.
You want to borrow the new car? You want to borrow my credit card?
Kids today, they really have it rough.
I have no idea where we are or where we're going.
I mean, when I was their age, life was easy. Super easy.
Why haven't you gotten a tattoo yet? How come you don't have any piercings yet?
Yep, we're lost. We are completely lost.
Ooh, sports.
Just do whatever the mechanic says to do.
Vehicle maintenance is completely overrated.
Look, whatever the mechanic is asking, just pay him. Pay him whatever he wants.
I wish they had soap operas at night.
I like that boy. You should date him. You should date him immediately.
Well, what about the creepy guy with the motorcycle? He's cute.
Yeah, sure. Spring break in Tahiti sounds fun. Hey, make sure you get all your video games done before you start your homework.
You don't have to pass all your classes.
What? You have a project due tomorrow and you've known about it for 4 weeks and you haven't started yet? Sweet!
Doesn't anybody want to know if we're there yet?
Remember, if you need anything between midnight and 4 a.m., please come wake me up.
Hey, I'm on the phone. Could you bring the baby over and let him climb all over me?
Hey, hey, can you please turn that music up?
Well, we just stopped for lunch 10 minutes ago, but yeah, let's stop again.
I never have trouble with my toddler.
I never have trouble with my teenagers.
I never have trouble with my adult children.
You know, she's right. We are ruining her life.
Yes, more homework to correct.
All right, whining.
Yay, tantrums.
Vomit.
We just really need to spoil these kids more.
Sorry, buddy. I don't know any good jokes at all.
You're 16. You pretty much know everything now.
I think 18's a great age to get married.
Okay, remember, make sure you turn on all the lights before you leave the house.
Hey, could you leave the front door open for a couple hours?
Thanks.
Whoa! Money really does grow on trees.
Our gospel is from Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 through 15. Please rise for the reading of the gospel. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door. Pray to your Father who is in secret. Your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. This is the gospel of the Lord.
We now continue our time of worship with our confession of faith. Today we're going to be using the Nicene Creed, a very, very ancient creed in the church, going back to 400 AD, which explains in detail what we believe in as Christ followers. So let us now confess to this world together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again according to the scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sit at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him in love. This is from the letter to the Ephesians from Paul the Apostle, chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Let us pray. Lord, just thank you for your word. Thank you for what Paul went through and how you blessed him with these words for us while he was in prison in service to you. Bless these words to our hearing in Jesus' name. Today we begin a series of sermons on the Apostle Paul's letter to the Ephesians. My assignment is to introduce the Apostle's letter and preach on the first 14 verses in chapter 1. His letter is what we call one of his prison epistles because it was written to the people of God in Ephesus while Paul was in chains for his proclamation of the Lord Jesus Christ in his death and resurrection. He wrote other letters from prison also, including Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. We believe the letter was written in about 60, the year 60, in the year of our Lord. It's not a long one, 6 chapters in all, but it contains some of the most meaningful and most quoted verses of the whole Bible. John Wesley said Paul wrote the letter to establish them in the doctrine he had delivered, to arm them against false teachers, and to build them up in love and holiness, both of heart and conversation. And Chuck Swindoll said, Ephesians deals with topics at the very core of what it means to be a Christian, both in faith and in practice, regardless of any particular problem in the community. He continues, Paul divided his letter to the Ephesians into two clear segments, applying the truths of the first makes possible the actions and lifestyle of the second. Very important principle. One way it's put is theology is practical. The gospel is practical, changes our lives, makes us new creatures. So what Paul says about everything that Christ has done for us, it works itself out in the second part of his letter to the Ephesians. There are several things that stand out about Paul's ministry in Ephesus. We read all about it in Acts chapter 18 and chapter 19. And I'm just going to give you a short summary of that. In Ephesus, Paul saw many people repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Wonderful thing. The Lord worked through the word. He also had tremendous opposition there. It was in Ephesus that those who came to faith in Christ burned their books. You may remember this. And idolatrous artifacts to the tune of 50,000 pieces of silver. Now, it's a very horrible thing that Judas did. He sold our Lord for 30 pieces of silver. That was the value he placed on our Lord and Savior. 30 pieces of silver betrayed the Lord. Yet here, when people came to know the Lord as our Savior, they destroyed 50,000 pieces of silver in value of their artifacts and these books and the magical arts and everything that they were practicing there in Ephesus. If you calculate that, the value of it, considering that a piece of silver was like one day's labor for a laborer, a day's pay, that would come up to 137 years of labor without a weekend, 7 days a week for 137 years. So obviously they saw something and they believed in something. And that was much greater than all the money in the world. They found Christ and believed him to be of greater value than anything that this world had to offer. So Paul saw the gospel being very effective in Ephesus. People turned to the Lord with their whole hearts. They gave up everything. They had found the treasure buried in the field, as the Lord talked about in one of his parables, where the man had found the treasure and then went and sold everything so that he could buy that field. And then the treasure would have been his. Well, that's what happens to us in Christ. Nothing else has any value. And we see the ultimate value of Christ Jesus as our Lord and Savior, having him in our lives and living for him. There's nothing greater than that. But of course, the devil doesn't like that one bit. So since Ephesus was one of the locations of one of the seven wonders of the world, the temple built to the goddess Artemis, she was called in the Greek Artemis, and in the Latin Diana, same idol, was a big attraction, one of the seven wonders of the world, who was a fertility and nature goddess. A lot of the opposition came from those who were making money by creating idols of this goddess out of silver. There was a silversmith. His name was Demetrius. We read in Acts chapter 19, starting at verse 26, Demetrius said, "Not only in Ephesus, but in almost all of Asia, this Paul has persuaded, turned away a great many people, saying that gods made with hands are not gods. And there is danger, not only that this trade of ours may come into disrepute, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis may be counted as nothing, and that she may even be deposed of her magnificence, she whom all of Asia and the world worship." There may have been a little bit of hyperbole there. Of course, when you wax eloquent in praising your idol, hyperbole is, of course, of great use. But in this case, for about 2 hours, they all cried out with one voice, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." It's strange how those who claim that Christians are fanatics for saying Jesus is the only way can then spend 2 hours crying out in unison, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." But we read, "All the residents of Asia heard the word of the Lord, both Jews and Greeks." So in the midst of all this that was going on, Paul and the disciples that were with him were still faithful in preaching the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And many were responding to that. The word was working. The seeds had been planted. The water had been given. And the sprouts came. God gave the increase. And many people turned to the Lord. This kind of thing, it's been the history of the church. Christians share the gospel of Christ, and we get various responses. We get some strong opposition, and we get some strong acceptance of the message. But our gospel is clear. Read further in Ephesians in chapter 1 and verse 20. "Which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places." Incidentally, the word places is not in the Greek. So another way that this could be said is set him at his own right hand in the heavenlies, which is not a place out there beyond the stars somewhere, but it's right here in our midst. The heavenlies, wherever Christ is, wherever the gospel is, there is Christ. There is heaven at that place. Jesus went and preached and said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Also, John the Baptizer preached the same thing. "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And then Christ appeared. Wherever Christ is, there is the kingdom of heaven. Wherever the church is, there is Christ. Wherever God's people are, there is Christ. So the kingdom of heaven is right here in our midst. In Ephesians 2 and verse 6, "And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." In Ephesians 2:13, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. Brought near through the blood of Christ. The kingdom of heaven is not far. We were once far away. We were far away from the kingdom of heaven. But through Christ, his death on the cross, through his blood, as it says specifically in verse 13 of chapter 2 in Ephesians, we were been brought near through the blood of Christ, his death on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. So we are blessed, my brothers and sisters. We see that one of the themes that I want to bring out is that we are blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. And more of this is going to come out about what those spiritual blessings actually are. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Verse 3 of chapter 1. Jesus said that whether two or more are gathered in his name, that he is there in the midst of them. So heavenly places are right here. The heavenlies are right here. Samaritan woman who talked with Jesus at the well one day was told she could drink of a water that would quench her thirst forever. Blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Jesus people. Well, I became a Christian in 1971, sometimes called Jesus freaks in the 60s and 70s, who discovered that sex, drugs, and rock and roll were the road to death. And that Jesus was the way, the truth, and the life. Blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. An inmate doing life in a maximum security prison who proclaims, as I heard him proclaim, in Calipatria State Prison, prison doesn't define me. He said he thanked God that he went to prison, because if he had not gone to prison, he would probably have never come to know Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Blessed in Christ, with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. The young lady who was baptized as an infant tells of how she does not remember a day when she was not a Christian or when she did not love the Lord. Blessed in Christ, with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. The old man who tells of how he went forward in an altar call when he was 15 and served the Lord since that time. Blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. People from every background, every ethnic group, Jew and Gentile, male and female, black, white, brown, police officer and criminal, who received the word when they heard it. Blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. In verse 13 and 14 of Ephesians 1, which was written not only to Ephesians, but in the plan of God to us today, says this: in him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. Blessed in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. The saints, as Paul called the Christians in Ephesus, although the city was the seat of the great goddess Diana or Artemis, were seated in heavenly places in Christ. They had found the hidden treasure in the field, sold all to obtain it. They counted everything else as nothing. They had burned their satanic books and believed the truth of the gospel, that there is only one way to God, and that is through the shed blood of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins and the gift of eternal life. It's no coincidence that the Apostle Paul, writing from prison, told about spiritual warfare and our being seated with Christ in the heavenlies, We're going to hear more about that as we go through this letter to the Ephesians. It's a very rich and wealthy letter, wealthy in Christ, where the true riches are in this world. May God bless his word to our hearing. In Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen.
Joy it is for us to be able to go to God with our prayers and concerns. And we now do that. So let us stand for our time of prayer. We pray. Lord God, we thank you for this day. And we thank you for this amazing book of the Bible, the book of Ephesians. Let us dig into this book and read it and understand it. Its wonderful message of how we are to live this Christian life and be a blessing to this world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray once again for our nation and our world. We pray for the families of 118,000 Americans who have died of COVID. We ask, Lord God, you'd be with those families, be with those who are recovering from this disease. And we thank you that Allison has survived and she is getting better. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for wisdom and blessings upon our national and local leadership. Let them guide us with wisdom and mercy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for the sick and ill who are part of our church family and in our lives. And we pray your healing upon Jen and Janice, Andy and Pat and Ken. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for godly fathers who will bless this world with love and wisdom. Let them spend time with their kids, no matter what age, and be a source of hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray your blessings upon our Vacation Bible School the second week of July. Be with those leaders as they put together this program and allow many kids to come and hear the wonderful news of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And Lord God, let us not forget that our mission here is to tell other people about Jesus, to bring them into the kingdom of God that they might have the assurance of eternal life. Help us this week to be there for the divine appointments you have given us, for us to witness to our faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And Lord God, we thank and we praise you that we are your people, that we are your church, we are the body of Christ. Let us go forth knowing how greatly we are loved. We ask this in the name of Jesus who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Parish announcements for Mount Calvary this day. Once again, if you'd like to sign up a child for Vacation Bible School, and they can be anywhere in the world, go to our church website. We will send them a box a couple days before Vacation Bible School, and they will meet with other kids on Zoom and with adult and teen leaders. And again, pray for our Vacation Bible School, that everything goes well and we proclaim the message of Christ. Our schools are taking registrations now for August, Lake Arid and Running Springs. And God has blessed our schools with amazing staff. So if you know somebody looking for a school, let them know that we are here. We take second grade up to or down to about 2 years old. If you're not receiving our church emails, if you're new to our church family, make sure you go to our website and fill out the information there. And you'll receive updates on all that is happening here at Mount Calvary. And once again, for those who wish, we do have live worship now. We have four different worship services, Saturday at 5:30, and then Sunday at 8, 9:30, and 11. We do keep people about 6 feet apart, and you do have to wear a mask when you're in worship here. But we are offering live worship, and everybody is welcome to come and worship here with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. So those are announcements for today. It is now time to receive God's blessings and go out into this world with the message of Jesus. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.